So the next item of business on the order paper is a motion on the humanitarian crisis. The business committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly expresses its despair at the ongoing international humanitarian crisis in Syria, notes the tragic deaths of refugees fleeing to Europe seeking sanctuary, and the terrible conditions endured by those refugees in transport to Europe and in refugee camps upon arrival, believes that EU nations have a moral obligation to assist people seeking refuge from war and prosecution. Further notes the Prime Minister's eventual decision to accept 20,000 refugees. Further believes that the UK government and some other EU governments have not acted in line with their humanitarian obligations, and calls on the Executive to ensure provisions are in place for Northern Ireland to welcome refugees from Syria.
Thank you, and I call Ms Anna Lowe to propose the motion.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. It has been more than 3 years since human rights groups confirmed the Syrian government's use of cluster bombs in an attack which killed innocent lives, many of whom were children. So far, 220,000 people have died and 4 million have been displaced. But it took the image of one dead child lying on the shores which his parents hoped would offer them safety to remind us of our common humanity and the need for action. There seems to be some confusion regarding whether a person is a refugee or an immigrant. Economic migrants are different to refugees fleeing conflict, and we must not conflate the two terms. We cannot let the politics of immigration stop us from helping those fleeing violence and persecution. Mr. Speaker, we are currently experiencing great political uncertainty at a time when we find it hard to agree on many things. This motion is surely something on which we can all unite. The compassion of Northern Irish people never ceases to amaze me. We have seen rallies, appeals, petitions, and people even offering to open up their homes to those in need. In a radio interview 3 weeks ago, I mentioned that the Alliance Party offices were taking collections for refugees in Calais. To be honest, for a few days it was difficult to move between desks in our premises with all the donations received. This is the best of Northern Ireland, and I would like to pay tribute to our generous people. Their response has been truly heartwarming. The UK government has undoubtedly been generous in aid terms. 0.7% of our GDP is rightly spent on international development. But we are here today to discuss the adequacy of the overall approach. Since 2011, the UK has granted humanitarian protection to almost 5,000 Syrians through normal asylum procedures. The Prime Minister recently announced that the UK would accept 20,000 Syrian refugees over 5 years, but 4,000 refugees a year is not enough. If Northern Ireland only takes 3% of that pro rata, that's 120 refugees per year. When you compare these refugees to the 800,000 welcomed into Germany, or the 24,000 in France, it's clear we could be doing more. Even Brazil, halfway across the world, has taken in 2,000 Syrian refugees. The crisis is now. We do not know what the situation will be in a few years' time. We should be doing all we can now. I welcome the Deputy Minister's proposal that Northern Ireland could accommodate 2,000 refugees. The public will is there. They want us to help. Mr. Speaker, we have a moral responsibility to help refugees, and Britain has a proud history of doing just that. At the end of the Vietnam War, Britain took in 19,000 Vietnamese, the so-called boat people, who were fleeing violence and persecution. In fact, I myself volunteered with the Red Cross then to help the Vietnamese families settle in Craigavon, people who not only integrated extremely well, but were entrepreneurial in setting up businesses and seeking employment. The Syrian refugees have much to offer our society. There are doctors, engineers, and other professionals in those refugee camps who are seeking a better life. Let them seek it here. However, good sentiments are not enough. We need a plan to ensure provisions are in place for us to welcome the refugees. This is OFM-DFM's responsibility, and I understand that the department is looking at various ways in which to help play our part and work with the Home Office and other departments. In terms of action, the Refugee Asylum Forum have produced a 5-point list of necessary measures to ensure the smooth process of integration for newly arrived refugees. The first is the call for refugee integration strategy. We are the only region in the UK currently without one, which is particularly pertinent given that integration continues to be something of a difficulty in our society. The Strategic Migration Partnership produced a paper in 2013 outlining what this strategy would look like. A key point was that actions taken by departments and agencies cannot be done in isolation. For meaningful integration of refugees, the approach must be collaborative. I would like clarification from OFM-DFM regarding whether they seek to introduce a refugee integration strategy and what interim measures they are planning to take to facilitate integration in the absence of the strategy.
Would the member give way?
Yes.
Member for giving way. The member be aware on the 9th of September, as Deputy Chair of the OFM-DFM Committee, I requested that officials seek an update from OFM-DFM with regards to the contact they've had with the Home Office and indeed on the refugee integration strategy. Would she agree that the people of Northern Ireland deserve a more fuller and formal statement from OFM-DFM with regards to these particular matters as a matter of urgency?
Absolutely, I totally agree with that. Thank the member for mentioning that. The Refugee Asylum Forum also calls for a long-term commitment to welcoming refugees, which is important. Our support should last beyond the news cycle, as well as the provision of free English classes and housing. The final request is that the executive work with our excellent support sector, some of whom I'm delighted are with us here today in our public gallery. These organisations are already on the ground supporting refugees and asylum seekers, and their expertise will be valuable. One cause for concern is that the OFM-DFM's track record in delivering is not always the best. Over the years, a number of organisations and churches have had to step in and provide support to refugees and asylum seekers in the absence of government support. For example, when OFM-DFM announced the introduction of the Crisis Fund to help the most vulnerable in 2014, it took a year until it was actually put in place. A small amount of money can make an enormous difference to these people, particularly to destitute asylum seekers who are often left in limbo with very few options and have difficulty accessing services. It is paramount that we ensure our services are prepared for the refugees we will be welcoming. I would ask that OFM-DFM ensure that generous offers made by the public can be turned into practical assistance, and I look forward to hearing in the near future from the department on the progress made in coordinating our efforts. The scale of this problem is huge, and there are no quick solutions. What is clear, however, is that there is a very great need for a coordinated European response. This is not just about taking in refugees. It is also about dealing with the root causes in conflict areas and tackling the criminal gangs preying on vulnerable refugees. As members will be aware, I have a particular interest in ending modern slavery and the unspeakable horrors refugees face at the hands of traffickers must be dealt with. I welcome the Home Secretary's recent joint declaration with France for new law enforcement collaboration and intelligence sharing. One of the most harrowing stories to emerge is of the 52 people who died in an airless hull of a boat. Those who survived this journey only did so because they could afford to pay to come up on deck to breathe. We cannot allow this to happen again. We must work together. Mr. Speaker, no one chooses to be a refugee, a person who risks everything, even life itself, in search of a tolerable existence is a person we must help. I urge you to support the motion.
Thank you, and I call Ms. Katrina Ruyan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'd like to thank Anna Lowe and her party for bringing forward this motion. And I absolutely agree with Ms. Anna Lowe in relation to no one chooses to be a refugee. None of us in this House would choose to be a refugee, leave our homes, leave our families and bring our children with us for many thousand miles. And just looking at the Global Trends 2014 report, and these are even outdated figures at this stage, in the world we have 59 million people who are forcibly displaced by persecution, conflict, generalised violence and human rights violations. We have 19.5 million refugees. We have 38.2 million internally displaced persons and asylum seekers. And just to put a context in this debate, who are the top host countries of these refugees? I can tell you, it's not Europe. It's Turkey, it's Pakistan, it's Lebanon, it's Iran, it's Ethiopia. The developing world hosts 86% of world's refugees. For example, of the 4 million Syrian refugees, 1.2 million are in Lebanon. That's one-fifth of the entire population of Lebanon. 6% have sought asylum in Europe. It's paltry, it's tiny, and yet look at how the European governments, with a few exceptions, are dealing with this. Look how many people have died coming to our shores. Look how many people are on rafts and boats that they are so dangerous for them, coming from Libya to Italy, coming from the Mediterranean Sea. It's a risky, dangerous journey, fleeing from a war, and war that was not of their making. Men, women and children leaving their homes because of policies made thousands of miles away in England, in the United States and in Europe, in China, in Russia, the bigger superpowers, fleeing because of global crisis, because of deep injustice and because of repression. And that crisis needs a global response. It needs a human rights-based response. It is not good enough for Europe to say it will not play its role. It's not good enough for countries like Hungary building fences to keep people out, a bit like what Israel does. We need a twofold approach. We need conflict resolution. The superpowers need to be challenged. They are the ones that have caused this conflict. As Ms. Lowe has said, we need to look at the root causes of conflict. We need to challenge the superpowers, the arms manufacturers. We also need to provide sanctuary for refugees. Citizens across Europe are ensuring that their voices are heard. We've seen them on this island. We've seen them in Dublin, in Belfast, Newry, in Fermanagh, in Derry, all over Ireland. And their voices are saying, refugees are welcome. Tá fáilte romhaibh to this island. We know what it's like to be fleeing in the coffin ships, in the boats. We know what it's like to be arriving at a country with nothing but the clothes on our back. That's what our ancestors did. We now need to open up our doors. And our governments in Ireland and in Europe need to follow the citizens. As usual, the citizens are leading from the front. I would like to put on record and pay tribute to what Martin McGuinness and the DFM office are doing. As the proposers of this motion will know, they're meeting with NGOs and community-based forums and representatives from councils across the north. Officials from OFM, DFM are also involved in a joined-up approach to support refugees who are coming here. John O'Dowd, and I welcome the fact that the Minister is here in the House, has tasked his officials with making preparations for children and education. But also, I do want to pay tribute to the Department of Education, who's been leading from the front. Indeed, during my own time, we brought forward the English as an Additional Language report, every school a good school, and extra resources was given to schools for every ethnic minority child that they had, so that they could put in place the special programmes. And that will continue. Sinn Féin support the key five actions as developed by the Refugee Asylum Forum and endorsed by the 16 organisations. And we very much welcome the work that we're doing, and we look forward to ongoing partnership working.
Thank you, and I call Ms Claire Hannah.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and commend the members for bringing this motion. It is vital that the Assembly continues to give voice to the solidarity of people here, the very clear solidarity with millions of people fleeing conflict in Syria and elsewhere, and it is also appropriate that we look at the practical support that we can offer. Members have outlined some of the context of this crisis, which has seen several hundred thousand people dead in Syria. I believe half of that country's population displaced and 12 million people in need of humanitarian assistance, including over 5 million children. And I think all the indicators are that these numbers will only get worse. It is vital to preserve the integrity of the word refugee here. Since 2011, life expectancy in Syria has decreased by 13 years. The country has seen a reversal of all progress made to the Millennium Development Goals, including numbers of children attending school having halved and a dramatic increase in acute malnutrition of children. So the suggestion that people who are crossing the sea in a boat or who are spending days in the back of a fridge or literally walking across countries with their children on their shoulders, the suggestion that they're doing that for a change of scenery or a new job is unconscionable, and it shouldn't be given the time of day. I think, Mr Speaker, all of us in the Chamber and I think across Europe have been very moved by those images of refugees making those desperate journeys to Europe. And as the Member pointed out, we should remember that it's only a tiny fraction of the numbers that are making their way and arriving in Europe, with the vast majority displaced in Syria and around 4 million in Turkey and Lebanon and Jordan and other nearby countries. And I know that the work done by aid agencies like Concern and Oxfam and TROCRA and Christian Aid, some of whom are with us today, will literally be meaning the difference between life and death for people at that very sharp end of the conflict. And I know that they are being generously supported by people here. The UK and Irish government have provided substantial financial aid to support the humanitarian needs of people in those camps in and near Syria, and that should continue and be increased. But we do know that the EU has a moral obligation to increase those safe legal routes into Europe for people fleeing literally the total destruction of their countries. The theory that search and rescue is a pull factor, it shouldn't be entertained, and it needs to be increased as well. We're going into the winter months when those desperate and dangerous journeys are going to become even more perilous, and that support should be enhanced. If we can't do that, I think the European Union will have lost sight of what it was intended to do. We should also remember, as other members have pointed out, that most of these people who have made their way to Europe will be skilled, educated workers who have a lot to offer here, as have previous economic migrants, and will bring substantial benefits to our economy and our community. The motion also calls on us to ensure the provisions are in place to welcome refugees to Syria. It is, of course, a reserve matter, but it's clear that there are gaps in ensuring the humane treatment of existing refugees and asylum seekers, as well as those who will hopefully come come from Syria. And it isn't enough for us to get into any sort of an auction about how many we're going to take without ensuring that that response is planned and properly funded. And I do welcome the guidance given by the Refugee and Asylum Forum on how we can better do that, and our party endorses those proposals. The key priority is, of course, a refugee integration strategy, as are in place elsewhere. And it does seem shameful that precisely the time that asylum seekers and refugees should be assisted to get on with their new life here, they are instead having to navigate complex bureaucratic and legal systems to get what they're entitled to do. And effectively, I understand each new arriver is having to reinvent the wheel in terms of legal support and of education and health that they can access. So I think vital organisations like the Law Centre, like Home Plus and Niagara's are providing that support, but a strategy that's developed by those providing that support would make that journey a lot easier. I understand that the racial equality strategy was receptive to it, but like another load of documents, it hasn't made its way out of the bunker of OFM, DFM, and now would be the appropriate time to do that, ideally with a central coordinating group like someone like the Law Centre, which will allow us to monitor the numbers as well and mean that statistics aren't muddied by those who are seeking to undermine the integration of refugees. Mr. Speaker, an open humanitarian response to this crisis is our moral obligation. It is the will of the people here, and we urge support of the motion.
Thank you. And as this is the first debate in which the Assembly will hear from Mr. Andy Allen, I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. And I call Mr. Andy Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm honoured to be in this House as a representative of East Belfast, where I was born and bred. I'd first of all like to pay tribute to Michael Copeland, who I know firsthand worked tirelessly and passionately for the people of the constituency. I would like to thank Michael for all his help and assistance in the past, and wish him well on what I hope will be a road to recovery. He was totally committed to his role as a public representative who sought to give a voice to people who often felt marginalised, and I promise that I shall do my best to ensure that I continue down that path. I am especially keen to tackle educational underachievement, which has affected too many young people from the East, housing stress, and to play my part and attracting jobs and investment to an area which was once Northern Ireland's economic powerhouse, but is now in need of help to restore its fortunes and give its people a sense of purpose. I'm up for that challenge. Mr. Speaker, it gives me no pleasure to speak on this motion. On the 2nd of September 2015, the world was shaken by the horrifying images of young Alan Kurdi's lifeless body washed up on a Turkish beach. There is no doubting the enormity of the humanitarian crisis which has emerged out of the chaos in the Middle East and North Africa. The Syrian civil war has now been raging for 4.5 years and has claimed the lives of 200,000 people. Because of the twinned evils of the barbaric Islamic State and the brutality of the Assad regime, each day there are fewer safe places in Syria and indeed the region in which it lies. The EU has struggled to cope, and in particular, governments in the Balkans have been forced to make policy on a hoof as border crossings are opened and closed almost on a whim as states become overwhelmed. I do, however, draw a distinction between genuine refugees who are fleeing persecution and violence and who have made their way to Europe in search of a place of safety, as opposed to economic migrants who are simply seeking access to Europe in search for a better life. We in Northern Ireland are not responsible for immigration policy or the granting of asylum, so we must work closely with the UK Government to help play our part in alleviating the suffering. Our natural sympathy and desire to help fellow human beings in a desperate plight needs to be matched with an appreciation of the practicalities of the situation. The Law Society has highlighted a number of key actions which are accompanied, like to see delivery. For those refugees who are accommodated in Northern Ireland, including a refugee integration strategy and free accredited English language classes for all refugees, I believe that these actions are in particular are vital if we are to allow those refugees who wish to settle here in Northern Ireland the opportunity opportunity to fully integrate into society. The Law Society also calls for a commitment to partnership working. I do not believe that this should be restricted to dealing with refugees who arrive in Northern Ireland. This Assembly should be developing partnership working between all departments and agencies as a matter of course. It is not enough to say that we will ensure that those entering Northern Ireland as refugees will receive the best possible support through healthcare, housing and education. That is something this Assembly and Executive should already be committed to delivering for every person in Northern Ireland. The Ulster Unionist Party fully supports the steps taken by the UK Government, including the spending of £900 million from its foreign aid budget on helping some of the 4 million refugees who have fled Syria since the war began. The vast majority of them are in refugee camps in neighbouring Turkey, Lebanon and Jordan, and the need for humanitarian aid is constant. In the longer term, political solutions are a much more effective response to the migrant crisis than opening up another country's borders. Syrian refugees accepted into Europe or the West are a small part of the total need. There are 4 million Syrian refugees living on bordering countries and another 78 million displaced Syrians living in government-controlled areas within Syria. Permitting more Syrians to emigrate addresses a symptom, but not the root cause. The majority of Syrian refugees do not want to emigrate to Europe or elsewhere, and we must work. We must work to ensure the causes of the flight of people from Syria, namely the brutal conflict in the region fuelled by the terrorism of Islamic State. Only then will the people of that region, who are currently displaced, be able to return home and rebuild theirs and their families' lives in their own country. Maybe we should pay heed to the words of a young Syrian boy trying to reach Europe who said, "Stop the war in Syria and we won't want to go to Europe."
Hear, hear.
Thank you. And I call Ms. Megan Ferran.
Thank you, Margaret Cancorla. Like the previous member, I would welcome the opportunity to speak on this debate. However, I think we would all rather that such a discussion wasn't necessary. We would all rather there was no such suffering in the world. But the heartbreaking images of the pain and suffering of refugees fleeing Syria have brought home to millions of people the need for urgent humanitarian action. And I think at the outset, it's worth noting that while Syria is to the fore of people's thoughts regarding this crisis, there are also people fleeing Palestine, Libya, Eritrea, Afghanistan and Iraq, to name a few. These are conflicts mostly caused or worsened by Western action, and so there is an onus and responsibility on governments to address these humanitarian issues as well. I also want to pay a tribute to my friend and colleague Martina Anderson, MEP, for the amazing work she's been doing on this issue. She is currently visiting a refugee camp in Jordan and has been visiting one in Italy as well. Her overwhelming passion on this issue is clear to be seen, and I know that there are many more like her. Speaking from Jordan this week, she said, "These refugees face the choice of dying in the conflict in Syria, drowning in the Mediterranean, or starving in refugee camps, and that is the dire situation we face," as the motion states. The response from people to the shocking pictures of the body of three-year-old Ireland Curdy washed ashore has shown the depth of feeling there is on this issue. In fact, once again, citizens have proven to be way ahead of the British and Irish governments by offering to do what they can, as Ms Lowe stated earlier, even opening up their own homes. We have not only an international obligation to act, but we have a human one. Ireland Curdy should have been playing on a beach, not washed up on one. But it shouldn't have taken such a picture to wake many up to the reality that these are our brothers and sisters, our fellow human beings. And do governments respond with humanity across Europe? No. Instead, they increase coercive measures to keep people out, to reinforce Fortress Europe. 30,000 men, women and children have drowned in the Mediterranean Sea in a desperate attempt to flee wars and persecution over the last number of years. I also want to say that the media and certain governments have a lot to answer for. They have been dehumanising refugees, provoking racism and xenophobia throughout Europe, and they need to take responsibility for their actions.
Thank you for the member for giving way. Would you agree with me that we need to stop the destitution of refugees, and we can do this by ensuring that there are as few administrative delays as possible so that they're not left without money? And would you also agree that we need a proper strategy for dealing with refugees so that there are plans to coordinate support services such as education, hate crime, jobs and integration?
Thanks, the member for her intervention. It is an important point, and I thank her for making that point. And it is important that whatever practical help we can offer refugees, that we do. So Europe has a responsibility to help these people. This is very much a crisis of European creation. Member states encouraged, started or participated in the wars these people are fleeing from. However, European policy allows member states to shake off their responsibilities. Europe must step up and commit to meaningful action on relocation and resettlement, providing a fresh start for many. We need to see a radical shift of migration and asylum policies across Europe. Indeed, the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union states that all have the right to dignity, which includes life, and freedoms, which include liberty, prohibition of all discrimination, and crucially, asylum. Closer to home, the Irish and British governments must do more to tackle this humanitarian disaster. The response of the Irish and British governments should match the scale of the crisis and the generosity of our people, which has once again been overwhelming. I think the response in all our local areas is something that we can be proud of. I know in my own area there have been solidarity collections and vigils held across Newry and South Armagh. I hope we can find a resolution to this crisis, one that puts people before politics. And one thing we can all agree on is that this executive should do everything in its power to help. A humanitarian crisis of this scale must be met with humanity. And perhaps in an unorthodox fashion, I'd just like to finish with an extract of a poem written about this crisis, which is called Home, and I think it's very powerful and brings home the reality that these people are facing. You only leave home when home won't let you stay. No one leaves home unless home chases you away. With fire under your feet, hot blood in your belly, it's not something you ever thought of doing until their blade burnt threats into your neck, and even then you carried the anthem under your breath. You have to understand that no one puts their children in a boat unless the water is safer than the land.
Thank you. I'll call Mr. Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, last night you yourself, along with colleague John Dallet, organised and hosted an event about the Great Famine, and I commend you for doing that. A major event in our history, one that we should never forget. And we shouldn't forget it because in the immediate aftermath of the Great Famine, 1 million people died, 1 million people travelled to other parts of the world, and many of those people died on coffin ships, or even if they did reach places like America, they received, in a lot of cases, a very hostile reception. Many others went on and did very well, and their families and subsequent generations ended up in very prominent positions in places like Washington, D.C. We, on the other hand, Mr. Speaker, many years later, haven't learnt that lesson, that we need to have open and welcoming countries for people who are in deep and real crises. If America, for example, had have been closed to Irish refugees, and that's what they were refugees, what would have happened to all those people? You know, people were dying in the ocean. People are dying in the ocean now, Mr. Speaker, in 2015. It isn't good enough. The founding values of the European Union, one of those founding values was about the protection of human dignity. I'm not so sure the scenes around the border, the borders of Hungary, are living up to that particular founding value. And I think there needs to be sanctions on European EU countries who do not live up to those values, because it is a stain on the reputation of the European Union. That instead of opening our arms to people who are fleeing brutal conflict, we close the doors and fire tear gas at them. I don't think that's something that we need to be, that we can be proud of at all. It's something we should be very, very ashamed of. And I think all of us as European citizens need to respond to that. And I know that in places like this city and my city and places all around the north, we've had demonstrations of people who have said that refugees are welcome in their homes. That's an illustration of the character of the people of this place. Even though we all have great difficulties here, there's 4,000 people on the waiting list for houses in Derry, people in Derry are still saying, come here, we look after you, we'll open our arms to you, because they understand the difficulties that people are going through. And I was criticised the last time this debate was, we had a matter of the day on this issue a couple of weeks ago, and I was criticised for making a political speech, and people told me it wasn't about politics and it's only about a humanitarian crisis. Well, these people aren't fleeing an earthquake, Mr. Speaker. These people are fleeing a man-made crisis. Whether it's the evil of Assad's regime or the evil of ISIS or the stupidity of Western governments and their interventions in places like Iraq, we have helped create this crisis. We need to help solve the problem as it stands, Mr. Speaker. So, you know, on that day as well, the First Minister, if that's what he still is, had made a comment about 5 minutes before I rose to speak that the executive wouldn't be meeting. We have a responsibility in these institutions to, in whatever way we have to, I know that a lot of these issues are reserved, but we have a responsibility in whatever way we need to and have to meet as an executive, to act in whatever way we need to act, and I'll allow the executive to make those decisions, but they can't make those decisions if they don't even act, if they don't even meet as an executive. The people out there are calling on, I think, the politicians up here, whatever our other difficulties, but to act on this particular issue, to be to the forefront of showing the compassion that's required to meet these refugees with open arms, to ensure that they're not living, if they do get this far, in destitute conditions like some of our recent refugees actually are living at the minute. So I would just call once again, because this is a political issue, Mr. Speaker, there are many major geopolitical implications for all of these things, but right now we have an executive that isn't meeting, and we have responsibilities. Our responsibilities aren't as large as the UK government's or the Irish government's or anybody else's, but we have responsibilities, and we cannot meet those responsibilities unless this executive meet, and I would encourage the First Minister to change his attitude to that. Thank you.
My comments are Jim Allister.
Thank you. Could I begin by congratulating Mr. Allen on his maiden speech? I think some of those he spoke subsequent to him have obviously forgotten the tradition of congratulating a person on their maiden speech, and I genuinely do that and wish him well and look forward to his further contributions. One would have to be utterly heartless not to be struck and very moved by the sheer devastation that we have seen in Syria, a country which has been bombed to a pulp by the various factions. And it is no surprise that in consequence of that, there is a migration of refugees. And I think we should approach their plight with considerable sympathy, and not just sympathy, but with stretching ourselves in terms of material and other support. But this is such an emotive subject that it's, if you dare to ask questions which in other circumstances would be objective and reasonable, you run the risk of being vilified for daring to raise those subjects. And being painted as someone, in fact, who is heartless. But with the spectacle that we're witnessing across Europe, I think there are questions that have to be asked. And I think we have to ask the question, are all those we're seeing on our screens truly refugees? There seems to be a great preponderance of young men, which speaks more, perhaps, of economic migration. And I think that we need to distinguish the necessity for our humanitarian response to a genuine refugee situation, which in international law is met in the country where the refugee first arrives. Not, yes?
Is the member prepared to accept that in this filtering process, to try and separate the deserving from the non-deserving, as he perhaps sees it, that we can contribute to human suffering and more people will die, rather than us simply having a more humanitarian approach and giving people the benefit of the doubt in the first instance?
I take the point, but you cannot, and Europe cannot, thank you, Canada as a whole, give a carte blanche with all the risks that come to Europe's security, with the possibility of those under the cloak of the cloud of refugees some being contained within it who are jihadists, who come to destroy, not to build their lives or anyone else's. So I think Europe has to be careful and has to approach this thing sensibly. But, you know, what I see is a great thrust of people who are determined that they are getting to Germany. Now, fine, people may have that aspiration, but is that the first priority of a refugee, or is safety the first priority of a refugee? And I think that one has to be careful about some of those matters. I think also this motion is a little unfair to the United Kingdom government, because it berates the government for not acting in line with the humanitarian obligations. United Kingdom government in the last 4 years has contributed more than any other European state in humanitarian aid. £920 million. In fact, and I think this is a point worth making, considerably more than many of the neighbouring Arab states in the Middle East, who have contributed paltry amounts in comparison with their wealth. You take the United Arab Emirates, one of the highest GDPs in the world. United Kingdom has contributed three times what the United Arab Emirates has contributed, three times almost what Saudi Arabia has contributed. So I think that there is an obligation on the adjacent Arab states which has not been fully and adequately met. And I think before we berate our own government, I think before we berate our own government about these matters, we need to recognise the scale of the contribution they've made, now approaching and soon to surpass £1 billion. So a motion which derides that with no criticism of other countries in Europe. You know, take some of the major countries in Europe. Take France, has contributed 70 million. 70 million in humanitarian aid, as opposed to the billion of the United Kingdom. So I do reject the notion that the United Kingdom has not lived up to that responsibility. And what is our responsibility in that context? Our responsibility in that context is to take our share of whatever the United Kingdom properly admits as a refugee quota. And that is our obligation as the devolved part of the United Kingdom, and I'm sure we will meet it and meet it handsomely. But it's not for this Assembly, which doesn't have control over these matters, to set artificial aspirations or to say that we will do things that we know we cannot do. Our obligation is to live within our responsibilities that our nation meets, and for our nation to meet its responsibilities, and in that way, we approach the thing properly.
And I call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'd like to echo the comments of Mr. Alistair in welcoming Mr. Allen and congratulating him on his maiden speech. I think the first thing that everybody is asked with this humanitarian crisis is what can I do? And it is time for this Assembly and these institutions to ask, what can we do? The public have stepped up, has been pointed out. People have offered spare rooms, they've offered their homes, they've offered to help. But what they have not seen is public services step in to facilitate that support that they wish to give. Towards the end of last week, I visited the North Down Calais Solidarity Group, and they're running out of space to take donations. So the public are stepping up, but what they need is statutory services to do what we can, what they can, to facilitate that goodwill that's there amongst our electorate, and to ensure that those who wish to help can give real help to those who are in a time of need. The Law Centre have launched their Safer campaign, calling for a big Northern Ireland welcome for refugees, and they've outlined some practical steps that this Assembly can take, and it will need a coordinated response, which will need the executive to meet, and for us to get past our current difficulties and give a real focus to this situation. Safer Campaign asks us to stop destitution, to ensure that refugees, when they come to our shores, do have the support to ensure their basic needs are met. Ask the experts, those who are experts in the situation that refugees and asylum seekers face. And we have, for example, NICRAS, who have come out in the media and said, you know, we've been doing this work for years, we have the expertise, but we need the additional support. If greater numbers are going to come in, they do need that support to carry on their excellent work. Financial help, and that doesn't have to be direct subsidy, which I know is always the almost the bogeyman that's created. These people come here for the you know, £45 a week or whatever it might be they can access on benefits. I know I wouldn't risk my life for that, Mr. Speaker, and I'm sure that the people travelling in the boats don't risk their life in the hope of the great boon of our benefit system. But it is about putting in the support systems in place to ensure that when we take in refugees with open arms, as our public have demanded, that we do so to offer them a better opportunity. English classes should be provided to ensure particularly children entering education have the best hope and equal opportunity in terms to realise their potential. And finally, a refugee strategy. And this isn't something new. Refugees have been coming to Northern Ireland, and the support mechanisms probably have not been sufficient, and that is being highlighted now by the attention that's been brought by the current humanitarian crisis which has been created. And the final ask from the Law Centre's campaign is to end the big injustice. And that is the assumption almost of guilt by those who seek refuge in the UK as a whole, that until we can process, we lock people up, innocent people in detention centres, including children, including families. The way we have deported people in the past, coming into their homes in the middle of the night, people who've made their lives here, who've become part of our community. We should have a humanitarian response to a humanitarian crisis. We should follow the lead of those citizens who've stepped up and said, I want to help. This Assembly should help.
Thank you, and I call Mr. David McNarty.
Thank you, Speaker, and I too welcome Andy Allen's contribution here in his maiden speech. I also welcome, because I've noted the criticism of the EU countries today in this debate, a criticism which I welcome because it's likely to impact on our exiting the EU in next year's referendum. And so, Speaker, we enter in this debate the realms of a definition. We've been there before with definitions. Here we have the definition of a migrant, which is why this motion to me is highly commendable. It's an expression of heartfelt human sympathy, which I believe this House can rise to and unanimously support. How we can feel anything else but the deepest humanitarian sympathy for genuine refugees caught up in an appalling war situation, in what for them is a no-choice situation, and a situation characterised by the most appalling levels of violence and brutality that's been visited on ordinary innocent civilians, who, I ask, would not try to do their best for their families, and especially for their children, when deprived of a future by warring savages who are destroying Syria's past, present and its future. It's said now that the grass is always greener for those who see in our country a minimum wage, for example, which is 9 times the amount they could expect to earn in their own country, and who would fault them? But on the other hand, in this debate, the question has to be, who can afford them? So we must follow the lead of Her Majesty's government in taking 20,000 genuine refugees over the next 4 years. And in this regard, I would ask that out of the 20,000 that the United Kingdom is taking, how many will be allocated to Northern Ireland? I would also ask where in Northern Ireland will be the planned reception centres? Where will they be located? It is decisions on this that will enable the proper level of forward planning. And I see an absence of forward planning just at this crucial moment. But that is so important in a refugee emergency situation. And it's vital that all those given refugee status are properly assessed so that they know where they stand and are properly catered for and looked after. In this regard, I have to say that I believe, as said before, many Arab countries, and in particularly rich countries like Saudi Arabia, should be doing far more to help refugees from Syria. And I also believe that the United States, now that they have at long last come forward and said yesterday that they will take refugees next year and the following year, that they should be explicit about the numbers that they will take. My own leader, my party leader, Nigel Farage, has drawn attention to the particular plight of Christian refugees from Syria who stand in the greatest danger from these ISIS fanatics. There are, for Christians, no safe camps that they can enter. And this is something which I believe a country like ours, with our Christian heritage, should be especially sensitive to. I would indeed remind the House that the mass migration of whole populations from North Africa and the Middle East, it's a long-term problem. It's been driven by water and by poverty and now by war. And it's going to need a great deal more thought and strategy than the simple but well-meaning, and we all have it, humanitarian response which we all share and which indeed this motion rightly calls for. And it is in this regard, Speaker, I would invite members to attend a talk given by UKIP's immigration spokesperson Steve Wolfe in the Skenis Centre in the Newtownards Road on the 2nd of October, where these major issues will be addressed. It has... Shirley.
Thank you, Member, for giving way. You talk about party colleagues. Recently, a South Down party colleague made some quite despicable comments about the Syrian refugee crisis. Will you take this opportunity today to distance yourself from those comments? Go Mugget.
Thank you. I have to be precise and tell the member I don't have a party colleague in South Down. As I was saying, it has to be about public perceptions based on accurate facts and proper information. And regrettably and too often, misinformation, Speaker, rumour and gossip has led to action based on ignorance. And we've seen it in our streets. And we've seen it particularly in Belfast. And in that regard, this House and no one who is active in politics can afford to avoid the issue of resentment. It is something we too are going to have to deal with appropriately and very, very properly. There is this problem on immigration, on the criminals that visit us on the back of immigration, and on the benefit tourists and on the lot. But on genuine refugees, this motion has my support.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Declan McAleer.
I want to take the opportunity to speak on the motion before us here today. And I also want to regret not being earlier to hear the maiden speech from Andrew Allen today here in the chamber. So I regret not being in for the maiden speech, but you're very welcome here to the chamber. I think all of us will be very much taken by the plight of the Syrian refugees, and indeed in local communities not throughout just my district, but throughout the north and throughout the country, we've seen a huge outpouring of grief by ordinary people who really want to do something to help resolve this plight. I was speaking recently to my colleague, Martina Anderson, the MEP, and she made the point that in the small strip of the Mediterranean Ocean between Italy and Libya, there's been 30,000 people have drowned there in the last 10 years. She says it's like a floating graveyard. So it is. But I took the images of the two young children who are Galip Kurdi and Eileen Kurdi, aged 5 and 3, fleeing Syria, and their young bodies being washed up on the beach. And I'm a parent of a 3-year-old child, and it struck me very, very sorely when I seen that there. I mean, I think most people connected with their own families, and it just took those images to make people realise the extent of the plight that these people are facing. And unfortunately, most of them only have 3 options. And again, Martina is just back from a refugee camp in Jordan, where there's 80,000 people crammed in together with very little water, no food, and very little hope in that camp. And they have 3 choices. They can either die in the conflict, they can drown in the Mediterranean Sea on a dinghy, or they can starve in refugee camps. So this is a huge humanitarian crisis of our time. And I think it's important that we do take a collaborative approach to this. And yesterday I raised the issue during OFM-DFM question time with the Acting First Minister Foster, and I was glad to note that there is a collaborative approach being planned with the Executive and indeed with the British Home Office. And I want to take this opportunity of speaking here today to commend the huge amount of support and solidarity that I have witnessed, not just in my political role, but also in my community role, by people, by ordinary people right throughout the country who want to do something. And indeed, I want to pay tribute to in Oma, for example, Ramona House has become a focal point for aid for the refugees, and that has been headed up by a team of volunteers, which Martina Anderson is actually there today, meeting those volunteers to commend their good work and to brief them on the situation. And whilst I've cited Oma, I'm conscious that that is happening right throughout the country. There has been a huge, huge level of volunteer effort by community people taking the next step. And I want to take this opportunity to commend them today, because that gives you heart, so it does. So just in conclusion, I think that it's important we look at this from all options. We look at EU level, we look at here in the Executive, in the Assembly, and we also look at the community level, and indeed all options must be explored to resolve this major humanitarian crisis of our time. Gramina Maagav.
Call Mr. Martin Mullier.
Apologies, Deputy Speaker. I was at a meeting of the Economy Committee earlier, so I missed the start of the debate. I want to make 3 quick points to echo some of the sentiments we've heard already today, but to give members some background also on the work that's gone on to date to help refugees through this crisis and the work that some of the great volunteer groups of Belfast have been involved in. It was December of last year that the Reverend Bill Shaw approached the Executive and asked that we would take in some Syrian refugees on the Vulnerable Persons Relocation Scheme. At that time, shamefully, the London Government had taken in only a few hundred people, despite the requests from the United Nations Refugee Agency that they take in many tens of thousands. And working with the Reverend Bill Shaw, I got to meet some exemplary organisations in the city of Belfast, and I see them again speaking in recent days, asking us to respond with big hearts, with a generous welcome to the refugees who will now be coming in. And I want to mention 3 of those, because the work they do reflects back to the points that Mr. Agnew made about the need for a coherent strategy and consistent help for those who work with asylum seekers and refugees. Mornington organisation on the Armour Road, which runs a food bank, and many other community outreach activities. But they, in recent months, have really been pressing society to respond to this global crisis. And Day and Daily, and last week, for example, on a Friday morning when they hold their food bank, they couldn't get the food bank closed because people were continuing to come. And many of those they help are asylum seekers. I want also to commend our young friend Jasper and the Tear Fund and the work he did and they did visiting camps in the Lebanon, refugee camps in Lebanon during the summer, coming back, raising £50,000 from local young people here involved in the faith community and bringing that to try and help the refugee crisis. And then finally, the third group, the International Presbyterian Meeting Point on Lisburn Road, again showing us how we should respond to our brothers and sisters who are in peril and in refugee camps by every day, the way they welcome in, educate. I heard Mr. Agnew talking about English classes. Educate, build, and try and create a welcoming environment for asylum seekers to try and get them permanent status. And when they get that, to try and make sure they play a full part in our society. I want to therefore commend the request and the 5 points put forward by our Law Society. I think we should and must unite around those. I think it's essential that we echo and mirror the response we've seen from the community. The community out there on all sides and all parties, even though one party isn't here today, all parties and all communities and all sectors of our community want to see refugees giving a welcome which is true to our values as a welcoming people and which reflects the welcome that we have received, whether Scots-Irish, Ulster Scots or Irish people, when we have travelled the globe. I want to finish, Deputy Speaker, Boylan Fuckleraff on our Gamradi in Alaban, of Iontussi and St Ubershaw. I want to finish by mentioning our friends in the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Executive, who have always been a little bit ahead of the curve in this, and who first put it up to Mr Cameron when he was refusing to respond to the United Nations Refugee Agency appeal for help, that they managed to get together a scheme to bring in some hundreds onto the Vulnerable Persons Relocation Scheme via London late last year and early this year. And again, they have now set up a task force led by Minister Humza Yousaf to look at the practical ways in which they will welcome, integrate and look after the refugees when they arrive. I think we can learn from that. And for me, if we are united in this, I think we are, despite maybe some discordant voices, we're united in this as a society and community. Let's get this done immediately. Let's put fire under the feet of Mr Cameron. We want to get the people released from the terrible conditions they're in and the danger they're in and welcomed into this society so that they can start to rebuild their lives.
I call Mr Stuart Dixon to wind up the debate on the motion.
Thank you. You, Deputy Speaker, and indeed can I start by thanking every single member who has contributed to this debate today, and of course particularly to Mr Andy Allen, and congratulate him on his maiden speech, and indeed some challenging points which he and others have made with regards to all of this. I do not intend, Deputy Speaker, to repeat the words that have been well said by individuals around the chamber. I'd rather like to, first of all, after thanking all of those who have spoken, to reference my colleague Anna Lowe and to congratulate her for proposing the motion, which, as many will have heard in the speeches here today, is about one of the greatest humanitarian crises that Europe and indeed the world has seen in the post-war era. And therefore, I think it is vital that she has brought that discussion to the House today. As we have heard, the world is experiencing a humanitarian disaster on a massive scale. For many, this was not truly brought home, and others have made reference to this, until we saw the distressing and deeply sad images of that 3-year-old child washed up on a beach in Turkey. Born in 2012, Ilan Kurdi never knew peace. By the time of his birth, the Syrian war had already begun. His parents sought to change that and to secure a stable life, free from the fear of oppression and death, and sought to reach other members of their family in a prosperous, free and stable Canada. Tragically, as we all know, Ilan and his brother and mother didn't make it to Canada. Their story is, of course, as we know, not unique, and since the beginning of the year, thousands have died making similar attempts to reach safety and the freedom of the on the peripheries of Europe. The photographs, however, have focused minds on the injustice and the suffering being felt, and reinforced that behind the statistics there are thousands upon thousands of individual human stories. As citizens of the world, it is incumbent upon us to respond to such disasters in a compassionate but also a meaningful way. Words that I believe have been stated by every member in their contribution today. In the past few weeks, people right across Northern Ireland, and I want to pay tribute to people in East Antrim, who have demonstrated such compassion in collecting items and funds for people in Calais and further afield in the Balkans and Italy. But local voluntary action isn't enough. The numbers are so large and the challenges so enormous. It takes...
Thank the member for giving way and apologise that I wasn't in for the earlier contributions in the debate. But would the member accept that Ireland, North and South, knows intimately the pain of emigration, and that at height Ireland's population was close to 9 million. We have significantly less than that now. We have space.
I would agree with the member, and therefore it is important, indeed vital, that we have a coordinated intergovernmental approach to dealing with these issues. Indeed, Deputy Speaker, it's for that reason that yesterday I wrote to the Home Secretary urging the UK Government to rapidly reconsider its position to accept only 20,000 refugees over the course of the next 5 years. This is quite simply a paltry figure, especially at a time when Germany's Interior Ministry says it expects to receive more than 800,000 asylum applications by the end of this year. Furthermore, to ensure the resettlement is as trauma-free as possible, we need a rapid government action to make effective social and financial provision for refugees that will come to the United Kingdom. Of course, we need a solution to the problems and the fighting and the wars and the terror gangs that are ruling Syria at this point in time. I firmly believe that those who are currently refugees, given a stable country, would wish to return there as soon as possible. But it is important that we have a strategy that includes refugee integration, assisting people in their new lives if this is where they choose to be and our government permits them entry, and to ensure that they do not become isolated. English language classes for those who do not speak English. OFM, DFM and the Home Office must act now to prepare such a plan and ensure the best possible welcome is extended to refugees when they arrive. But ultimately, Deputy Speaker, this is not only a United Kingdom, German or Greek problem, nor indeed is it a European problem. This is a world crisis. Gulf states must certainly step up their support to the neighbours in the region. Fabulously wealthy nations of Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, the UAE, Qatar have merely stood by while Europe, Turkey, Lebanon and Jordan have shouldered much of the crisis. Indeed, some states which themselves suffer and find it struggle to feed and support their own citizens. The small state of Lebanon has taken in an estimated 1.1 million refugees. We must provide serious support both nationally and at EU level to these states and ultimately seek a long-term lasting solution to end the evil that we see in Syria and Iraq in the form of Assad and the group that calls itself Islamic State. Deputy Speaker, compassion and action is what is needed to end this crisis. The United Kingdom Government must fulfil its international legal and moral obligations and accept its fair share of refugees. We must show solidarity with our European neighbours, but most of all, the people escaping conflict from wretched regimes which seek to destroy the human spirit and denigrate utterly the value of human life. It's for these reasons that I know this House today will support this motion. No one chooses to be a refugee were words that were said in this chamber today. But those that are refugees should be made welcome in the United Kingdom and in this corner of the United Kingdom. Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The next item.